times I've questioned certain circumstances and things I could not understand. And many times in trial, weakness blurs my vision. That's when my frustration gets so out of hand.
It's then I am reminded that I've never been forsaken, and I never had to stand one test alone. When I look at all my victories and the Spirit rises up in me, then it's through the fire my weakness is made strong. He never promised that the cross would not get heavy and the hill would not be hard to climb. He never offered our victories without fighting, but he said help would always come in time. So just remember when you're standing in the valley of decision, and the adversary says, give in. Just hold on. My Lord will show up, and he will take you through the fire again.
I know that in myself that I would surely perish, but if I trust the mighty hand of God, he'll shield the flames again and again.
He never promised that the cross would not get heavy and the hill would not be hard to climb. He never offered our victories without fighting, but he said help would always come in time. So just remember when you're standing in the valley of decision, and the adversary says, give in. Just hold on. My Lord will show up, and he will take you through the fire again. Just hold on. My Lord will show up, and he will take you through the fire again. Hold on.
Grace. to the 10 people that are here and the potential hundreds of millions in our viewer audience. And because you think about it, everybody that's on Facebook and YouTube could potentially watch us now. So wow, are we creating opportunity. And well, thanks for joining us, whether you're at home or in your office or wherever you're at, joining us digitally. And we sure appreciate you doing so. We are doing well here at Heartland Baptist. We're still filling our week with ministry, taking care of people. Of course, a lot of it's through phone calls and different ways, and we're just trying to be a blessing to those and keeping the Bible being taught. From all of, my wife even started doing a Noah's Ark Sunday school lesson for preschoolers, and so I'm proud of that. And so now we've got something online for preschoolers, elementary, teenagers, young adults, adults, and then of course our own church services too, along with prayer times and Bible studies on Wednesday morning and Wednesday nights. So thanks for joining us. Let's have a word of prayer. Our Lord, we come before you today, and Lord, again, we lift up our country. We lift up our state. Lord, we lift up our city and surrounding towns. Lord, we lift up this this church and this congregation. And Lord, I just openly ask that you would mitigate and restrain this virus. Lord, it has taken many lives already. It has cost many people their employment. Lord, it has added stress and anxiousness to many other folks. Lord, it has even caused us not to meet together to worship you. And so, Lord, we are looking forward to doing that again. Lord, I pray that it'll be soon. Lord, I also pray that you'll protect the congregation here supernaturally. Still today, Lord, I'm unaware of anybody in our congregation that has this, although I know of secondary relatives and friends who have, but Lord, nobody in our congregation as of yet. And so, Lord, I'm just asking that you supernaturally protect us. Lord, be with our efforts in ministering. It has surely changed, but Lord, we have adapted and trying our best to still reach out and with the gospel and with your word. And so, Lord, it is our prayer that you'll bless those efforts. And Lord, be with our service today in Jesus' name. Amen. Morning again. Turn in your Bibles to the book of Genesis, chapter 32. The book of Genesis, chapter 32. And today we start a 3-week series. I'm just being transparent with you, I had something else already planned and studied for and outlined, but the Lord laid on my heart that I needed to preach something different for the next 3 weeks, and trying to, just talk about what it means to be between a rock and a hard place. And today we're going to look in Genesis 32, when you have an appointment with your enemy. So again, I realize you may not stand at home, but here we're going to stand. So folks, if you'll stand as we read just 12 verses from Genesis 32. It says here in the Bible, "And Jacob went on his way, and the angels of God met him. And when Jacob saw them, he said, 'This is God's host,' and he called the name of that place Mahanaim. And Jacob sent messengers before him to Esau, his brother, unto the land of Seir in the country of Edom. And he commanded them, saying, 'Thus shall ye speak unto my lord Esau, thy servant Jacob saith thus, I have sojourned with Laban and stayed there until now. I have oxen and asses and flocks and men servants and women servants, and I have sent to tell my lord that I may find grace in thy sight.'" Verse 6. "And the messengers returned to Jacob, saying, 'We have come to thy brother Esau, and also he cometh to meet thee, and 400 men with him.' Then Jacob was greatly afraid and distressed. And he divided the people that was with him, and the flocks and the herds and the camels, into two bands. And said, 'If Esau come to the one company and smite it, then the other company which is left shall escape.' And Jacob said, 'O God of my father Abraham, and God of my father Isaac, the Lord which saidst unto me, Return unto thy country and to thy kindred, I will deal well with thee. I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and of all the truth which thou hast shown unto thy servant, for with my staff I passed over this Jordan. And now I am become two bands. Deliver me, I pray thee, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he will come and smite me and the mother with the children. And thou saidst, I will surely do thee good, and make thy seed as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude.'" Let's have a word of prayer. Lord, we ask that you'd bless the reading and preaching of your word. And Lord, it is my hope and my prayer that you will use this passage and this sermon, not only, Lord, to help people to think through that, when we're between a rock and a hard place, it is a challenge. But Lord, help us to see that you are always there with us and the great many things that you work to bring about. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, at one time or another, I think we've all felt what it's like to be between a rock and a hard place. The phrase refers to when we feel like we have two choices and both are bad. I can tell you a lot of my decisions lately have felt like that. You know, it's like, okay, well, there's just no good choices. The phrase is uniquely American. It came from the copper miners in Arizona in the 1900s. Where they were working in these copper mines for the mining companies, and the conditions were not very good. They were not very safe, and people were being injured, and so they called that the rock. And then the other choice is that some people were trying to get them to sort of protest, and so far everybody that had protested had lost their job, got laid off, and immediately found themselves in poverty, and that was the hard place. So those copper miners in Arizona, they developed that phrase, between a rock and a hard place. In the last month, a lot of us have felt that on one hand, wanting to be safe and yet needing to work. We felt like, yeah, we get that. We feel like we're between a rock and a hard place. Some of us, we want to shake hands. We want to show some affection, and yet social distancing keeps us from doing that. And we want to see our family and friends. On one hand, we want to honor the government, and yet I'm telling you, we feel like our freedoms are being infringed upon. Often, it seems there are no good choices. And I want you to know, I was thinking this week about, you know, if you're, we have people in our church who are business owners and supervisors and managers and doctors and principals and crew leaders, and they've had to make some very difficult decisions about whose hours to reduce and who to lay off, and they don't want to do any of it, but it's either do that or they can't figure out how to social distance the workplace environment, or they can't keep the company afloat if they don't reduce some payroll. I want you to know there's lots of people that feel like, man, I get this between a rock and a hard place thing. The first account that we're looking at today is when Jacob was told by God to return to Canaan. That's his hometown. That's where he grew up. And that's where he still had some relatives. The problem was that the last time he was there, his brother Esau said, "The next time I see you, I'm going to kill you." You see, Jacob had swindled Esau out of his inheritance, and he did so by pretending to be Esau before his father Isaac, and Isaac was blind and couldn't hear very well and was way up in years, and he swindled Esau out of everything. Now, I just want you to think for a minute. How would you feel if someone left you an inheritance and a position and a job title and some blessings, and then somebody dressed up like you, faked your voice, and did all sorts of things to deceive whoever was involved, and they then took everything that was rightfully yours? This is the first case of identity theft. Esau should have had LifeLock, but that didn't exist back then. He couldn't call anybody to get made whole because his identity had been stolen. Well, Esau was livid, as you can imagine, and told Jacob, he says, "I'm going to kill you." And that's what prompted their mother to send Jacob away to live with their uncle. Years had gone by now, though. They'd all grown up, married, had kids, and God now tells Jacob, "Get back to Canaan. That's the promised land. That's where I want you. That's where I told your grandfather, Abraham, that I was going to give that land to you." And then on top of that, Laban and his household, they knew of God, but they also worshipped idols. And we know that even Jacob's wife Rachel dabbled in idol worship, or at least she thought it was like a good luck charm. And so Jacob knew, for the sake of his family and to stay in God's will, he needed to go back to Canaan. But from everything Jacob remembered about hot-headed Esau, nothing had changed. Let's stop for a minute and put ourselves in Jacob's shoes. I mean, he knew what God was asking, but he was scared. I want you to notice in verse 7 of our text, it says, "Then Jacob was greatly afraid." He was greatly afraid because he knew his brother. He was greatly afraid because he was now married. I mean, he couldn't just, I mean, if he lost his life, well, yeah, okay, maybe he'd be okay with that. But now, oh no, he's got a wife, children, he's got people depending on him. It scared him. It scared him because he'd also worked for 20 years to build up some things. And now it was all in jeopardy. It was all being risked. And then, of course, it sure didn't help in verse 6. That Jacob sent a messenger to go tell Esau, and I don't know, you know, "Hey, guess what? I'm coming home." And the messenger comes back and really isn't able to convey any emotions about Esau's answer other than, "Yeah, I gave the message to Esau. Esau said he's looking forward to it, and he's coming with 400 men. That's a battalion, if you can picture that. And so I'm just telling you, I don't think Jacob, I mean, he was greatly afraid for a reason. One time, it was early on in my pastoring timeline here in Iowa, maybe 10, 12 years ago, I was called out to this home where this husband and wife were not getting along. And they each had big families. And so, but I try to respond to everything I possibly can. And so I'm sure I'll come out and see if I can help you work something out. And I get out there and I show up and they're literally throwing things at each other. I'm not exaggerating at all. They're throwing things at each other. And I get them to sit down on this picnic table outside where they lived. They had a picnic table out in their front yard. And so we sit down and I'm kind of bringing up some things. I mean, as they're telling me, I'm like, okay, is that true? You know, to the other one, is that true? You actually did that? And they don't like being called on the carpet that, you know, and some of the things they're doing, it's just mean things. But what I notice is that as I'm getting on to the guy, his three brothers start circling behind me. And I want you to know, I can identify with the greatly afraid. I just can. And now it ended up turning out just fine, but I didn't like that. I was uncomfortable. I mean, I kept talking to him and to her, and then I'd look behind me, and I understand how Jacob felt. He felt like he just thought he was done. He thought his goose was cooked. But Jacob trusted the Lord, and he determined to obey in spite of fear. Now, I'm just going to prompt this here for just a moment. It's easy to obey when everything's great. I want to challenge you, obey when it's difficult. Obey God's word when it's difficult. Obey the Lord when it's challenging. That's what gets noticed. He obeyed in spite of fear. He obeyed in spite of being afraid. And I noticed that God both gave Jacob wisdom because of that, not only in knowing what to do, but then God went to work in all sorts of other ways too. And God, I think, literally came and inserted himself right there with Jacob between a rock and a hard place. Here's some observations from our passage. We're going to have a few of those, and then I'm going to show you what God did. First of all, when we're between a rock and a hard place, here's what Jacob did. Now, maybe this doesn't apply to every scenario we're ever in, but I tell you what, it may apply to a lot of them. First of all, he looked for affirmation. If you'll notice in chapter 32, verse 1 and 2, God sent two angels. And I'm thinking that's because Jacob's like, Lord, give me a sign. Tell me if I'm on the right path. Tell me if I'm on the right track. Lord, am I doing the right thing? And I think anytime we have tough things to do, that we have tough decisions to make, I think we ought to be smart and wise and say, Lord, help me to know if I'm on the right track. We can learn a lot from Jacob. When we don't know what to do, God will provide a hint as to whether we're making the right call. I'm just giving you a personal example. When the order came to close in-person services, over 10 people. I want you to know, I'm like, goodness sakes, what in the world? And then I hear that some pastors are not going to do it, and then a bunch of them already had done it before they had to, I'm like, well, what in the world? I mean, it's just all so new, and it's like, wow. And I wanted some affirmation. I prayed for wisdom, and the first thing I looked up was, what are other godly pastors doing, guys that I respect? When I saw Albert Moeller, Charles Stanley, David Jeremiah, and Robert Jeffries all voluntarily going online, I'm like, okay, well, there's four good men that would never abandon the Lord, and if they're doing it, it must be okay. And then other pastors in our state started calling me. And I sure am glad I figured out what to do and whether it was okay or not before I got those phone calls, because I was able to tell them not what we were doing, but then also, but here's what some other guys are doing. You know those names. I thought of Proverbs 12, verse 15. When you don't know what to do, boy, you ought to stop for a minute and say, hey, I need to get some good godly advice. This great verse, the way of the fool is right in his own eyes. And if you're not careful, and if I'm not careful, We'll get stubborn over something, and then we start defending our stubbornness, and then we double down to doubly defend our decision. But the way of the fool is always right in his own eyes. Of course, he's a fool. But he that hearkeneth unto counsel is wise. Secondly, I notice that Jacob showed respect to Esau. Now, he may have thought, well, Esau, that was so long ago. How come Esau hadn't let this go? Boy, it seems like such a small thing compared to everything else we went through. It doesn't matter. Jacob still determined to show respect to Esau. I noticed that when he sent his servants to go see his brother, he says, now you call him Lord Esau. We'd all be wise in talking to those in authority with respect and using respectful words. He wanted Esau to know, I'm not coming back to take over the family farm. I want nothing from you. You don't have to worry about me. What I did as a young man so many years ago, that was foolish, and I've got nothing to do with that anymore. I want to remind you that as you talk to people who are in charge of things, remember, you're not the only one who's stressed. I'm telling you, we got enough folks in our church that are in leadership positions in companies and business and, you know, even down to the crew leader having to decide which crew leaders are going to get their hours cut. I mean, you're not the only one who's stressed. Be considerate. Be respectful. I find in verse number 5, he even says, you tell him, I want to find grace in his sight. Meaning that he said that phrase just means, Esau, I don't even deserve it, but I want to find some grace in your sight. As different people make tough decisions in these days, and even though I think we, you know, I'm just praying that we've already reached that peak of the pandemic here in our country and we're on the downhill slope, I sure hope that's the case. But I want you to know that the tough decision time is still not going to be over for a while. I want to just remind you, and I want to give you some advice. If you're an employee and your boss may have to make a decision down the road, boy, you want to be the person that was early to work and worked hard and did your job and didn't complain and was a team player. You know, I've known lots of rebels in my life, rebels in the workplace and rebels in the army, and I'm going to tell you, rebels usually end up unemployed and broke. That's how rebels usually end up. So you be careful about wanting to be that person. When I was a deacon back at my home church in Indiana, there was a young man, he was on church staff, and I don't know what it was, something happened, the pastor made some decision, and I mean, it wasn't some theological issue, it was just something about some Sunday school room or something like that, and boy, he got all mad. He got mad, and he started talking to people, and he came to me as a deacon wanting to know if I'd be on his side, and I told him, I says, well, first of all, I said, I'm compassionate, and I understand why you're upset, but that doesn't mean I'm for you going against the pastor. In fact, I'm the opposite. I said, I'm not going to support you rebelling against the pastor, and I want you to know that flat out. And I want you to know I'm going to go and talk to the pastor about this conversation. That's how loyal I am to the pastor. And I want you to know now, he wouldn't let it go. He wouldn't lay it down. He kept trying to fan the flames, and frankly, over something that was just small potatoes, he ended up getting mad and quitting. I saw him about a year later. He had a minimum wage job, and you know, I'm like, hey, how's it going? He goes, well, I showed him. I'm like, oh yeah, that worked out great for you, didn't it? You know, I'm just telling you, be careful about copping an attitude. It's always okay to bring up suggestions, to ask questions, but be careful. Well, what else? Jacob recognized the wrong that he'd done. If you look in verse 20, and we didn't read down that far, but look in verse 20, and Jacob says, and you say, moreover, behold, thy servant Jacob is behind us. And he said, I will appease him. Well, there's a word that you only use if you admit that you've done wrong to somebody. Jacob wanted to appease him. And I want you to think about this. When you are in conflict with someone, it doesn't matter if it's real or perceived. They still feel the same way. I've got one case right now of somebody. In fact, I guess I got two of them. I just want you to know, I don't know what I did. I don't know what I did. I saw somebody here this last week, and you know, I hadn't seen him in a long old time, and I'm like, hey, you know, I mean, I've called, sent cards, all that stuff, and I'm like, hey, man, how you doing? Obviously, we've disconnected. Is everything okay? And they're like, no. And I'm like, well, okay. Well, I said, what's up? And they told me, and I'm going to tell you, I have no clue what they're talking about. And I'm like, oh, I don't remember saying that. I didn't mean it. That was never my intention. I know myself well enough. I would never do that. It didn't matter. And I want you to know, I stood right there and I said, but whatever it was, I'm sorry. I don't remember that being the case at all, but I sure am sorry. I want you to know, if you've got somebody in your life and the relationship is, I mean, it's a loggerheads, you may say, well, they're just blowing it out of proportion. Well, maybe, but it doesn't matter. Their feelings are real. And Jacob, I just think he says, I want to appease him, and I want you to know, it may take a while. I got another one, another relationship. I can tell right now, it's going to take a while. I don't understand it all. I don't know how we got to where we're at, but I'm trying to make amends, and it may take a while. It may take a year to convince somebody that I don't even know how to explain what I'm after. I'm just trying to appease and show that I care about them and that I'm sincere in trying to get things back to the way they used to be. Jacob was apologizing, and I want you to know, it's pride in someone that won't apologize. It's just flat out pride. And you may say, well, I didn't do anything wrong. That's not the point. The point is, will you say, you know, for whatever my part is, I'm sorry, and I do want things to be back the way they should be. Now, in all of this, here, that's just a few little things that Jacob did, but now here's the bigger and best part of the sermon. Here's what God was at work at too. And my point is, and this is the great part, when we're between a rock and a hard place and we seek God, I'm telling you, God gets to work. First of all, in verse number 9, the crisis sent Jacob to his knees in prayer. And in verse 9, Jacob starts praying a prayer. It was prayers of necessity are often great prayers. I mean, when we're in trouble, when we're in a pickle, when we're in or between a rock and a hard place, we pray, I'm telling you, we pray great prayers. And this is no different. Man, what a prayer it was. God, he reminded God of who his parents and grandparents were. I'd never thought about until this sermon. That his parents served him, that his grandparents served God. He reminded God that he was trying to be faithful. He reminded God that God had told him that it's going to be okay and that God was going to bless him. He also, in verse 10, he humbled himself before the Lord. He's in verse 10, he says, I'm not worthy of the least of all the mercies. In verse 11, he reminds God of his promise again. And then in verse 12, he just says, God, I'm telling you, I need you, but here's what I'm counting on you to do. So I just want to give you an example, and I want you to know, I think we can all pray a prayer like this. I'm just going to give you a modern day 2020 example, and here's what my prayer might be. So God, my parents served you. I mean, they were faithful to church. They ministered. My dad was a deacon. He drove a church bus. He always tithed, gave to missions, always helped the pastor. God, my mom taught Sunday school. In fact, she taught preschool for 40 years, Lord. Lord, my grandparents helped Greg Dixon at Indianapolis Baptist Temple, and they taught Sunday school and were in the greeter ministry. And Lord, my whole family's got a record with you of serving you. Lord, I want you to know I don't deserve anything. I'm just humbling myself before you. But man, Lord, this is terrible. Lord, I want you to know I'm trying to be faithful. I'm only here because you brought me here. You called me here. Lord, this is how you're leading me. This is where I'm supposed to be in your will. And Lord, I'm just begging you. I'm begging you for help. And Lord, I want to remind you of your promise, that you promised to take care of those that believe in you and serve you and that have called on your son Jesus for salvation. So there's an example of a personal prayer, and I think you ought to pray a prayer like that. Tell God how you've served Him, how much you love Him, what you have done, maybe when it was another tough time. Humble yourself and say, boy, Lord, I'm not worthy, I'm not deserving, but Lord, I'm just begging you, I'm asking you. And Lord, you have promised to take care of us. Secondly, this crisis got Jacob alone with God. In verse 24, as the chapter moves along, Jacob separated from everybody that last night before he was going to meet Esau, and he got alone with God. Now, I'm kind of glad he didn't have a smartphone, because if he'd had a smartphone, he'd probably been scrolling Facebook or too busy texting or playing a stupid game on his phone or something else, and maybe he wouldn't have been alone with God. I want you to know it's important to spend time alone with God. Let me encourage you to spend some time talking to the One who knows all things, who can change anything He chooses, because He can always find a way out, even when we don't think there is one. Now, I'm just telling you, maybe you need to go for a walk. Maybe you need to go and sit out on the back deck, or maybe you need to take a drive, or whatever you need to do. We all need time alone with God. Thirdly, that crisis put some spiritual determination in old Jacob. In verse 26, this is in the passage where the Lord Jesus comes from heaven, and it says, the angel, this is one of those things we call a Christophany or a Theophany, an Old Testament appearance of the Lord Jesus. He's come to talk to Jacob, but when Jacob wanted to leave, or I'm sorry, when Christ wanted to leave, Jacob grabbed a hold of him and wouldn't let him go. Now, first of all, I just want to say that takes some gumption. It takes some gumption when you've prayed so hard that the Lord shows up and then He wants to leave, and somehow you reach out and you grab a hold of Him and you won't let Him go, even when He says, "Let me go." Oh, Jacob said, "I ain't letting you go." And I want you to understand why. Jacob thought he had about a 50-50 chance of dying tomorrow by Esau's hand. He didn't have anything to lose. You know, it's a lot of times when we got nothing left to lose that we really get serious about doing business with God. You wonder sometimes if God doesn't allow that to happen more and more often, because then He knows that's when we get close to Him. Well, Jacob was between a rock and a hard place. He didn't have anything to lose, and he held on to the Lord. And I want you to know, I've done this sometimes where in my prayer, I'm like, "Lord God, I'm not getting up. I'm not finishing this prayer. Lord, I need Your help. I need an answer. I need to know that You've got it. I need to know that it's going to be okay." That's what Jacob did. And by the time he was done, Jesus promised, and I mean promised, that he was going to be okay. What a prayer. And then lastly, God changed Esau's heart. In the next chapter, you can read about how when Esau shows up, Esau wasn't even mad. Now, when did Esau's heart change? Well, the Bible doesn't tell us. I mean, did Esau's heart change years earlier, but Jacob didn't know about it? Maybe. Did Esau's heart change when he got the message that his brother was coming back? Well, maybe. Did Esau get the message that Jacob was coming back, and he tells 400 men to saddle up and let's go get him? And on the way, while Jacob's praying and spending time alone with God, and Jacob's wrestling with the Lord and saying, "Lord, I'm not letting go until You confirm that I'm going to be okay." Is that wind riding along on that camel? Esau's like, "You know, that was a long time ago." Was it when the presents started showing up? You know, they come across somebody and here's a few servants with some sheep, and they're like, "This is a gift from Jacob." I mean, did that actually soften Esau's heart? Well, the Bible didn't tell us. I'm going to say I think it doesn't tell us for a reason, because those are all great ideas and great things that we should be doing when we're in trouble. Well, I'm going to tell you, it won't be till heaven that we're going to find out when God changed Esau's heart, but God did. And by the way, Esau ends up telling Jacob, Jacob, I'm wealthy. I don't need your stuff. Take it all back. I just want to ask you this. In verse number 30, let's read that real quick. And Jacob called the name of the place Peniel. For I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved. Have you found your Peniel, where you've come face to face with God? And if you haven't, I'm going to tell you, every Christian should probably have a few times in their life when they've been to a Peniel and they've talked to the Lord God. I'm telling you, you better have come face to face with God over your sin when you realize that you're a sinner, condemned, and you're going to spend eternity in hell, but God has offered salvation through His Son Jesus. And if we will cry out for salvation and admit that we're a sinner, you've come face to face with God and been forgiven. Well, I'm going to tell you, a lot of Christians think that's the last time they need to talk to God. Oh, my friend, not true. Jacob was a believer. And when he needed something, when he needed God to intervene, he grabbed a hold of God in prayer and wouldn't let go until he got an answer. And I want you to know, a lot of us ought to be doing that. We ought to be saying that, you know, every Christian, I think, at some point needs to say, Lord, I give in, I surrender. Have you ever surrendered to the Lord's will where you say, Lord, whatever you want out of me, that's what I'll do. And Lord, it may be doing what I'm doing. It may be something else. Likely there's some tweaks and some changes that need to happen. But Lord, whatever that is, I'll do. Have you come face to face with God and surrendered your will? Have you decided to make Jesus not just your Savior, but your Lord? My friend, I hope you have. And maybe you might want to ask, Lord, what do you want next out of me? Have you come face to face with God? Let's close. And by way of an invitation, let's close in prayer. Our Lord God, we humbly come before you. Lord, we want to come face to face to you. We want to grab a hold of you, Lord, and say, Lord, preserve our lives. Lord, take care of us. Lord, bless us. Lord, protect us. Lord, put a hedge around us. Lord, give us insight. Give us wisdom. Give us discernment. Lord, help us to know in our hearts that it's going to be okay and that you are on the throne and we just need to trust you. Lord, we do that. But Lord, we could use a sign. We could use some help. We could use a message. Lord, may this passage comfort our hearts. May this passage prop us up and encourage us. And Lord, may this passage bring us face to face with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this morning, one of our deacons, we're having a deacon every Sunday, John Beasley. Come on up, John. And John and his wife, Cheryl, they help in our Noah's Ark ministry when we're having services. But John's here to pray for the offering. And again, I just want to thank you for being faithful.
Let us pray for our offering. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we are not worthy of the blessings that you've bestowed upon us, Father. We humble ourselves before you in a virus-ravaged land, Father, and we just pray that you would hear our cries and that for those who need your help, that you would provide the blessings to them, Father. And we pray, Father, that people around the world would see this as an opportunity, that you are the way, the truth, and the life, and Father, that no one can find true life unless they come to you. And Father, as we collect offerings, we just thank you, Father, for those who are able to give. We thank you for those who have given online and for those who have dropped their offering off throughout the week. And lastly, Father, for those who have come in person to drop off their offering for the service. We pray, Father, that it would be used for your glory, for your kingdom, and for all that you will do in the land. It is in your name that we pray. Amen.
Hi from the Dennises.
Hi, church family. Yeah. From the McNalls.
Hello from the Rings.
Hi, we're Maddie and Jerry Rogers, and we're blessed.
Hello from the Schlegel House.
Hi. Hi from the Stokers.
Hi, everyone from the Youngman household. Miss everybody. You think about being gone from everybody from church and how bad you miss everyone, and you look forward to that fellowship, and if you just look forward to the fellowship we'll have once we all get to heaven. So we look forward to that time. Miss you for now.
I miss everyone. We'll look forward to seeing you soon.
Miss you all.
All right. Bye-bye. Bye. From Youngman's.